YouTube, William Tyndale here. I just wanted to make this video on the heels of the previous video I just uploaded with Ian Paisley, entitled The Power of the True Logos. For whatever reason, I'm unable to comment on that video, and the information here was going to be included there. However, I don't know if YouTube's going through another change, if it's messing with its format again, or it's the content of the video itself that is in question, but for whatever reason, I'm unable to comment under there. And I received a comment from a longtime friend and subscriber saying, "I don't understand logos. What is this about?" On which a friend and dear brother in Christ wrote concerning the historic Christian interpretation of logos, referencing John 1, Hebrews 1, the creation account in Genesis, so forth. Under that, I was going to post a detailed unpacking my motivation for the video and this subtle attack I see coming up on the logos. The very logos itself in this day and age is being called into question, like all other truth. And subtle twisting and revisionism of it is happening. And I believe, once again, it's under the oversight of the Jesuit order. The guy that's the spearhead of this attack, D. Michael Jones, one of the Jews are behind it all, historical revisionists now rife within the truth community, is a Catholic. He points to the Jews like they all do, when we know that the battle is not against flesh and blood. Even though there's plenty of Jews that are doing their bidding in high places, it's not fundamentally an ethnic battle, but one of Antichrist versus Christ, where the real line is drawn up. The curious thing is, these guys never preach the gospel. No matter what they do, it's always another gospel. It's another works-based, esoteric, Gnostic, New Age, counterfeit, ultimately, even though they use all the lingo of the church. It confuses many people. And so that's what this video is going to attempt to do, is counter this new narrative on what the logos is. Ferret the truth from the lies, so to speak. So first, here is a clip where this man, E. Michael Jones, speaks concerning the logos, and then I'll address it.
We have a word that really doesn't mean anything, but when you're talking about logos, logos is the order of the universe. It does mean word. Okay, yeah, that's the basis of it. That's the foundation. It also means speech. It means human speech because humans are the only people who speak to each other. Then it means discourse. Then it means rationality. Then it means reason. Then it means the order of the universe. And finally, when Saint John appropriates it, it means God. So what we have here is basically a word that needs to be expanded, an English word that needs to be expanded by learning Greek.
Now, this is all true in its proper context, but the deception or hijacking of the true understanding of logos is not in what is said here, but in what is not said. Jones does not understand, and whether that's intentionally misunderstanding it or by virtue of being spiritually blind by not being infilled with the logos, in that he does not have the spirit within him by having come to Christ in simple childlike faith, asking for forgiveness of his sins and to be cleansed by the working of Christ and in a true contrite heart. Where we know in Corinthians it talks about God confounds the wise of this world and causes them through spiritual blindness to not see his light, his truth. Whichever way it is, what he's putting forward doesn't comprehend that the logos is so much more. As mind-blowing as that is, that the logos is, in fact, the word of God, and therefore the order he has infused into and ordained over his creation, it is so much more than the order he is infused into and ordained over his creation. Although there is an order infused into and ordained over creation by its creator, i.e., from the natural laws of physics to his eternal moral law to laws of logic, etc., to the order and biology of kind procreating kind, the function of cells, and the atomic structure that is the fabric of the physical reality, and the setup of marriage and family, and the biblical ecclesiastical setup of the church, and the ordination of man's government, etc. This order, we Bible-believing Christians believe, was spoken into existence by the word, logos, of God, through Christ Jesus when he created all things in a state that was good, which is to say, perfect, in harmony and order, without blemish, fault, or disorder. So he set the created world up in such a way to render good. It was set up towards order, not disorder, which is completely at odds with man's theory of evolution, which would have order arising out of chaos, same as his new world order of ordo op cheo. So to quote Hebrews 11:3, through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. And this is Colossians 1:17 through 18 now. For by him, or Christ Jesus, were all things created, that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him. And he is before all things, and by him all things consist. So he's by his very word, he holds together the very fabric of the universe at the atomic level, at the physical level, at the spiritual level, whatever sphere of the world we're talking about. That's why Hebrews 11 talks about worlds. It's not talking about plural earths. It's talking about whatever sphere of existence we are designating here, that is, in totality, man's existence in this temporal plane and the spiritual eternity which surrounds it. He's holding it together. All things are held together by the Logos, by his word. We see God speaking into existence all things during the creation account listed in Genesis. This is Christ, the embodiment of the Logo, God in bodily form, the Word made flesh that dwelt among us, creating all things through the power of his word, or his Logos. So here's the passage from John 1. In the beginning was the Word, or Logos, and the Word, Logos, was with God, and the Word, or Logos, was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. That last verse is key. Notice it says that the darkness comprehended it not. This darkness is spiritual blindness that can only see symptoms and effects, but never understand the true cause or its nature. It can understand a concept of the Logos insofar as it pertains to the natural world and deity, an impersonal deity that is not a personal knowledge of and relationship with Jesus Christ that can only come from being born again in by and through his spirit. But their spiritual blindness causes them to not comprehend the true life-giving power of the Logos and will always deviate into Gnosticism, which is essentially chasing after more and more esoteric or hidden knowledge at the expense of the true knowledge of Christ found in him as the son or daughter of God. The Logos is the light and life of men. It saves their eternal souls and brings them into communion with their Creator and only possible Savior. It has the power to work through them, but not in their own puny, finite physical strength, but by his Spirit. Remember, the word says, not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord. This power is found in the Word of God, which is Christ, the Logos incarnate, through the reading and drinking in and infilling and application of his revelation we have recorded in written form in Scripture. So you have the big W word, which is Jesus Christ, and the little W word, which is Scripture. But you don't have one without the other. Jesus Christ as God and God as his word are inseparable. Just like the Trinity, God in three persons, is inseparable. This true Logos and its power to save souls and to cause men to bow the knee before God rather than man is why Rome and its Antichrist spirit of control through spiritual darkness is always at war with the book and the people of the book. They have sought through their diabolical Jesuit-led counter-reformation to subvert the Christian nations that threw off the yoke of the papacy during the Reformation, where the reading of God's word worked to illumine the hearts and minds of men and seek after Christ alone instead of man-made systems and institutions that cruelly suppress them both physically and spiritually. And they're still at work, though their methods have evolved with the times to be even more insidious, subtle, and cunning. They no longer burn books. They don't have to. The real histories are left to go out of print, while the neo-revisionist theories of those pointing to the crafty Jews abound. But more than that, they have created a culture of conditioning rather than true education, wherein the Bible is the cornerstone and bedrock, where people of their own mind-controlled volition do not want to read. They do not read the Bible for themselves or the history of the Bible and the Church of Christ, which is anything but Rome, and how they have been miraculously preserved despite the cruelest persecutions. They forever suppress the truth and unrighteousness. And now, they're even subtly attempting to revise the meaning and true understanding of the very Logos. And they do that by denying its power. That was the whole purpose of showing it through Ian Paisley and what he said, that the Word of God is the power. We don't stand there, we don't have to argue in our flesh and try to tear down the New World Order by politics and this or that man-made power. Like they're trotting all these right-wing alternative media types out to give us a sense of identity where we can somehow take back the culture from the progressive, regressive leftists that they've pitted as our adversary. When the reality is both sides are antichrist. Fundamentally, they deny Christ. These are not people who are Christian. They use Christianity as a political ploy. They subvert and twist the true meaning of Christianity to make it into a cultural concept. These people are not Christians. There's not a blood-bought Christian among them. And how are you going to get truth from someone outside of the truth? This is the question. This is the fundamental question that must be answered. They can speak a whole lot of truth, and they can appeal to what you want to be true, and they can show you all these lies about what the ridiculous nonsense of the baby butchers and the Satanists are up to, and these gender benders and all the rest of it. But they're not leading you in the way of Christ. They're not showing you. They'll put before your eyes some psychobabble about alpha male this and beta male that. That stuff is rooted in man-god philosophies. It has no basis in Christianity. A Christian man who is strong is a meek man. That's not weak. It's to say that he is not out there trying to have his own way. He's out there preaching the word of God. He's out there loving his enemy. He's out there turning the other cheek that the power of the gospel might be revealed. Okay? This is the insidious nature of these people where they're pitting this thing where you got to hammer them back. You got to knock them down. That's what to be a Christian is now. They've tied this thing. Because they've destroyed the family and the male, the man of God. They've destroyed him in their culture. They then put up a caricature of masculinity, a caricature of femininity, and they say chase that. And so you got this alpha male MGTOW deception out there, where it's basically things that are essentially male. But they're not necessarily Christian. They're not necessarily what it is to be on the side of righteousness. Sometimes you gotta deny your own will, and that might look like weakness to the world, but it ain't. It's anything but that. It's allowing God to work through you, because when we are weak in our flesh, He is strong, because His strength is gonna show through our physical infirmity. A man that's out there, look at me, I'm so big, tough, and strong. That's appealing. That's the Sauls of the world. That's the Barabbases of the world. That's the Trumps of this world. Where that stuff sells in the political realm. We want to hit go eye for eye with our enemy. But is that what God teaches us in His Word? Is that how the gospel has been spread? No, the gospel has been spread in the face of the utmost persecution, where the saints have died on the pyres of those who suppress His Word. And now, in these latter times, they've taken this insidious methodology of coming up and saying, oh, we're really Christians too. We believe in your Bible. We believe in Christ. And they have a semblance of Christianity, a semblance of godliness, but they ultimately deny the power thereof. They've created this culture of conditioning. They don't need to burn books anymore. They let the real books go out of print. And then they create a culture where people are constantly absorbed in their entertainment. They don't want to read books. They don't even want to read. And what they have to read is just to titillate their senses. It's a methodology, again, born out of the 19th century psychobabble, where they threw out God, they treated man like an animal, and then conditioned him like an animal. Well, you can always appeal to a man's base nature as an animal, and give him everything he wants in his base nature and control him with it. That's the sin nature. That's the flesh the Bible talks about. But the Bible is after the higher nature of man, his spiritual essence, his soul. And that is why the Logos is the Word of God. It reaches in, divides asunder, sharper than a two-edged sword, and speaks straight to who we are as human beings in a way that all their politics never reaches to. No matter how on point they are about dissecting the leftist narrative and all that, they don't bring you to the truth, do they? Do they ever bring you to the truth? I haven't seen it. So these people don't want to read. They've created a culture where people don't want to read. They don't read the Bible for themselves or the history of the Bible and the Church of Christ and how they've been miraculously preserved despite the cruelest persecutions. They forever suppress the truth and unrighteousness, as the Bible says. And now, they're even subtly attempting to revise the meaning and true understanding of the very Logos. And this is where I just can't sit back anymore and watch it happen. I mean, they appeal to me, because that's the whole thing. They're coming at with these minority groups, so they're going to try to appeal to me as a Christian white male and say, look at how they're attacking you. And so now I'm supposed to take up an identity of being a Christian white male? No, I'm going to take up my identity in the Logos. My identity is found in Christ as a Christian. That's where I can unite across any superficial boundary that the adversary wants to create for me to accept my identity in. My identity is spiritual. That's where the war is fought. They revise the meaning and true understanding of the very Logos by denying its power. And the Bible has warned us explicitly of this. Check this out. This know also that in the last days perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection. And that's not just talking homosexuality. That's talking about mothers that kill their children, wives and husbands that kill each other, husbands that destroy their families and slaughter their families. I mean, these are the natural affection is supposed to be towards the young. And you see sex trafficking, just abominable things going on in the dark. This is all part of this. Truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, thinking a lot about themselves, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. And then this is key, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. And it says, from such turn away. For of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women laden with sins, led away with diverse lusts, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. That's quoting 2 Timothy 3, 1-7. So notice specifically verse 5. This whole passage speaks most exactingly of the Roman priesthood. You can see Charles Shaniqui's 19th century work, The Priest, the Woman, and the Confessional, to understand verse 6. And these methods, of course, have continued to this very day in various forms. It's not just the Roman priesthood. I'm just saying that this is most exactingly explicit of the Roman priesthood. Verse 7 is a very concise summation of Gnosticism, with its drive to unlock the secret mysteries through esoteric knowledge. Yet, this knowledge is secret and hidden from them specifically because they have rejected Christ's atonement for sin and his victory over sin and death through his resurrection and are therefore against Christ. It's hidden because it requires spiritual sight, but they have gouged out their eyes thinking they see the sun. So Jones goes on.
Now, the point of the gospel here is,
first, we must ascertain what Jones means by the gospel. Is he speaking of the gospel of Jesus Christ come to save those that are lost? Or is he speaking another gospel, a social gospel?
There are three areas in which the church is not preaching the gospel. The first area is the Jews. The church is not preaching the gospel. St. Paul said the Jews killed Christ and they are enemies of the entire human race.
So Jones twists Paul's words to the Thessalonians in order to make it seem like he's saying the Jews are the enemies of all mankind. So let's read 1 Thessalonians 2:14 through 16 to see what Paul was really getting at. So Paul says, "For this cause also thank we God without ceasing, because when ye received the word of God which ye heard from us, ye received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth the word of God, which effectually worketh also in you that believe. For ye, brethren, became followers of the churches of God, which in Judea are in Christ Jesus. For ye also have suffered like things of your own countrymen, even as they have of the Jews, who both killed the Lord Jesus and their own prophets, and have persecuted us. And they please not God, and are contrary to all men, forbidding us to speak to the Gentiles that they might be saved, to fill up their sins alway. For their wrath has come upon them to the uttermost. So here we see Paul's clearly saying to the Gentile believers in Thessalonica that he praises God that they receive God's word as God's word, not the word of men, because in so doing it's working in you as the Logos. And Paul's saying, I know you've suffered persecution from your own countrymen, other Gentiles, just like the Jewish believers in Judea have been persecuted by the unbelieving Jews, who are the same ones who put Christ to death and oppose all men everywhere who preach the gospel of Jesus Christ and forbid us to even speak to you, that you might be saved. So he's not saying that this obstinance to the gospel is exclusive to the Jews. He's trying to bolster the Gentile converts in Thessalonica by telling them, just as they're being persecuted by their own countrymen, so the Jewish believers before them in Judea are persecuted by their countrymen. In other words, expect persecution from those around you if you follow Christ. And while Jones will say that the Jews who believed became Christians, or at least he'll say those that were baptized became Catholics, and he is speaking of the unbelieving Jews, he makes no distinction between those ethnically Jewish unbelievers he claims run the world, lumping them all together as the enemies of the human race, despite the obvious fact that Jews are no more united as a people group than any other ethnic group. There are Jews who are atheists, nominal Jews who appreciate their Jewish roots without practicing the precepts of the Torah, and what of the ultra-Orthodox Jews who are as opposed to the Zionist state as any on the face of the earth?
It's become so ingrained in every Jew that he is a revolutionary that oftentimes you don't need a plan. They just come together.
This smear of the Jewish people in toto is as lazy and anti-intellectual an approach as any group that says the white man is the devil or black people are stupid and lazy. It's fundamentally a doctrine of hate, fomenting division and an air of superiority in its proponents that can only be of the devil, in that it directly opposes what has been revealed by God to man in the Bible.
Okay, when St. Peter went to Rome, to Jerusalem, I'm sorry, the first thing he said to the Jews was, you killed Christ. And the Jews were cut to the heart. And then the Jews said, what must we do to be saved? And he said, you have to be baptized. That's the essence of the Christian faith. And no one's preaching it. Certainly not to the Jews. They're bragging that they don't have an apostolate to the Jews anymore. So that's a disaster. The second one is the relationship between church and state. And the third area is usury. But there is movement there because Pope Francis comes from South America, an area that has been exploited by American economic imperialism. They know these problems firsthand. His father used to have seminars on Quadragesimo Anno, the encyclical of the 1930s on Catholic social teaching. So he's aware of that, and I expect there will be more statements attacking this unjust capitalist economic system from the Pope.
So the gospel for E. Michael Jones is essentially speaking what he would consider truth to the social economic realm. It's not the biblical gospel of preaching Christ come to save the lost in repentance and faith, but rather to speak against the Jews as enemies of mankind and therein somehow convert them to Catholicism. Notice he says that to be baptized is the essence of the Christian faith. This is another lie of omission utilized to prop up Romanist doctrine. What Peter actually said was to repent and be baptized, just as Christ said to repent and believe the gospel. Reading from Acts 2:38-39, then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you, and to your children, and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And in Mark 1:14-15, now after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God, and saying, the time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye, and believe the gospel. Baptism is an outward show of an inward reality. If you've not repented of sin and turned to Christ as your Savior, no baptism is going to save you. Sprinkling infants into the Catholic Church hasn't saved a single soul. You find nothing like that being practiced in Scripture, not by Christ or his apostles. This is exactly what the Apostle Paul calls another gospel. Listen to what he says in 2 Corinthians 11:3-4. But I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. For if he that cometh preacheth another Jesus, whom we have not preached, or if ye receive another spirit, which ye have not received, or another gospel, which ye have not accepted, ye might well bear with him. So he says, I fear you might get deceived by these deceivers that are going to come after me. In Galatians 1:6-9, he says, I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another. So he's saying there's only one, but some people in their subtle deception will preach something that sounds like it, but it isn't. They'll call it the gospel, but it isn't. But there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I now again. If any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed. And what was this gospel that was once delivered to the saints? We go to 1 Corinthians 15:1-4. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. E. Michael Jones also believes this other gospel should be preached against the separation of church and state, as he reiterates here.
And what we're hoping for is a re-examination of the relationship between church and state, because the de facto interpretation of the Vatican Council was the separation of church and state was a good thing. That's not what the council document said, but that's the interpretation that's been imposed on the document, and it has had disastrous effects for the church and for the world.
These traditionalist Catholics want to see Rome restored as a theocracy, holding power over the spiritual and temporal affairs of men. He wants the Dark Ages all over again. I can't think of a greater threat to religious liberty than that idea. We have never seen this go well, whether it's the Muslims, whether it's Protestants, whether it's Catholics. It always goes into persecution. But having the Vatican as the spiritual and political leader over the New World Order is in perfect keeping with the Jesuit anti-Reformation toward which he is working as a Jesuit coadjutor.
I mean, we're talking about a Jesuit, okay? I was taught by the Jesuits.
After novitiate and first studies, Jesuits in training move on to the third stage of formation, regency. Regency is a time to take a break from studies and get immersed into full-time Jesuit ministry. Some regents work at Jesuit universities, others in international assignments, like working with Jesuit Refugee Service, and others might do jobs tailored to specific talents they want to develop. For example, prison ministry, or work in a Jesuit media apostolate.
People who appear to be in opposition politically or financially or industrially or in many ways are working together. You'll find that men in the same society will take opposite positions in public.
He also brings up usury, which I agree is the foundation of the current corrupt system and spoken against in Scripture. Although, if you're going to be historically accurate, you have to point to the Vatican and the European nobility as to the ones who allowed that to become a thing. Even if they used the papal court Jews, they were still the ones that allowed them to do that. They specifically set those people up so that it would look like they were keeping the commandment against it, but they were the ones profiting from it directly. And then whenever anything happened, they could blame the Jews. And look at Rothschild, the Red Shield. He changed his name. And if you look up Rothschild in the 1906 Jewish Encyclopedia, it clearly says they're the guardians of the Vatican treasure. But regardless of all that, speaking against usury is not the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's another gospel. If you're going to say it's a gospel, it's another gospel. So Jones goes on.
I came to this term because I wrote The Jewish Revolutionary Spirit. And in order to write the Jewish revolutionary spirit, I had to use the word logos, because no other word would do. So the thesis of that book is basically that when the Jews were God's chosen people, when Jesus Christ appeared on earth, they had to make a decision whether they're going to accept the Messiah on his terms or on their terms. Okay. The Jews who accepted Jesus Christ as the Messiah are known as Christians. It's the Catholic Church. This is the new Israel. This is the new covenant, the people of the new covenant. The Jews who rejected him are known as Jews. Okay. When they rejected Jesus Christ, the Jews rejected Logos. When they rejected Logos, they rejected the order of the universe and God's plan. When they rejected that, they became revolutionaries, and that's what they've been ever since.
Now, once again, there's a good deal of truth in what he says. But remember, the devil is subtle. And we know that the recipe for the most effective deception is one part lie to 99 parts truth to make the lie palatable. But swallowing the lie is the real purpose and intent of disseminating the truth with which it's mixed. So let's address what he says here. Are the Jews the only people with a revolutionary spirit? Are not all men who turn from Christ rebels and at war with God? Look at yourself. I look at myself. I know I was a rebel. I'm not a Jew. Are they all not infected with a revolutionary spirit? Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, male or female, when they rebel against God and against His Holy One? So why are the Jews the target? See, if you understand history, one sees that the Jesuits are the ones behind every revolution of the modern age. But it is the Jews, they say. Why? Because certain henchmen of the New World Order, particularly in areas of banking and media, are of Jewish descent. Is our battle against flesh and blood, i.e. bound by race and ethnicity, or is it a spiritual battle against wickedness in high places? So we go to Ephesians 6:12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. A battle against flesh and blood would look at the ethnicity of certain conspirators, while turning a selective blind eye to others, and if sufficiently blind to the true histories and the workings of man's nobility and hierarchy, sum it up to the Jews. A battle against spiritual wickedness in high places would see our adversary, the devil, leading a revolution against God from the time he rebelled and was cast to earth from heaven with a third of the angels who followed him in revolt, utilizing a false light of illumination, in other words, esoteric knowledge, hence the Illuminati, which is fundamentally the Antichrist spirit alive upon the earth. It's the ancient Babylonian mystery school religion of the One World Order, united since the Counter-Reformation under its high priest, comprised of the Jesuit inner circle and the hierarchy of all the clandestine groups under their control, such as the CIA and other intelligence agencies, foreign and domestic, and Freemasonry. But E. Michael Jones is right to say the Jews had to make a decision to accept the Messiah, the Christ, the Holy One of Israel, on his terms, not their own, or they would reject the Logos. The problem is, Jones is subtly twisting this truth to make it seem plausible that the battle is flesh and blood and not against spiritual wickedness, which is the Antichrist spirit and those, I believe, Jones, like another Jones, is serving to protect. The high priests of the neo yet ancient world religion of enlightenment that is really spiritual darkness and being in revolt against the true Logos and light of the world, Jesus Christ. And he has a form of godliness. He sounds right on much of what he says about God and even Christ Jesus. But ultimately, in not proclaiming the true gospel of salvation in, by, and through Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and instead preaching another gospel of a Logos who is simply the order of the universe, which the real Logos, of course, is, but so much more, specifically in the issue of salvation and the spiritual battle and the power of God whereby we are to fight it, he denies the very power of God and his word, or Logos. So really what Jones does is put forward a works-based salvation that is no salvation at all because we cannot save ourselves because of the sin we have committed. Our good works or what we know are worth filthy rags to atone for our sin. We need the spotless lamb to be our propitiation. That's the payment for a debt rightly owed, which we definitely owe for God having transgressed his eternal moral law. Jones's gospel is essentially that it is what one does that merits their salvation. In other words, accepting an intellectual concept or creed rather than to humbly call on God to forgive us of our sin. And he points to the harlot of Rome as the true church, when she is the very seed of Antichrist. This is so, so important. This is how the falling away happens. They're everywhere now. They're at the door. They are at the door. And who is there left to stand up? You know, I feel unworthy to even have any say in any of this. I know the devil is trying to destroy me unbelievably. I mean, the force of evil and trying to silence me, make it so I feel like I shouldn't say nothing. But I got to speak out. I got to say it. I got to stand for Christ, and so do you. If you know him, you have to stand up in these last days. Our time, I don't know how much time is left, but it sure seems like the gates of hell are wide open right now. If we understand church history and the machinations of Rome and the fact that Jones is ultimately pointing to her as the answer, which is the same as the protocols of the learned elders of Zion forged by a Jesuit priest, which demonizes the Jews and extols the virtues of the papacy as the only real hope of mankind to oppose them, and how for centuries they've subverted Christian nations in order to bring the world back under the control of Rome and have never changed their goal, but only made their methods harder to discern, what are we to conclude about the Logos Jones refers to? Remember, the Bible explicitly warns us to watch out for another gospel. To preach another Christ is to be cursed, it says. To preach another Logos. Logos, the Word, this is Christ. He's not proclaiming the Logos in all his fullness, so therefore he is preaching another Logos. It is not a lie of commission, it is a lie of omission. He's not telling the whole story. This is a lie nonetheless. It's an intentional deception. What reason? He speaks of the Logos as being reason. So what reason is Jones speaking to in reference to what is the Logos? Is he speaking to the God-given reason that is a tool of the mind he has given us in order to make sense of our world and his revelation to us? Or is it the capital R reason of the Age of Reason, which ultimately exalts man, which resulted in the French Revolution that was fomented by the Jesuit order and became the archetype for all later revolutions? What order of the universe is Jones really speaking to? Is this the order ordained by God, or is it the secret order of the ages people like Manly P. Hall have spoken about? The New World Order, that is the same as the Old World Order, uniting mankind under Antichrist. Beware, wolves in sheep's clothing. It's so subtle. It's just like the flat earth deception of tying passages, not at all, clearly not at all in context, speaking of astronomy, to a flawed model of the earth, that when people finally do see the curvature, they're going to say the Bible is not true. You know, I would have stayed out of that flat earth argument if people weren't tying it to the validity of the Bible and the historic interpretations of those passages that were anything but talking about the physical earth. 90% of them were talking about the order God instilled in his creation, both the physical order and the government that he has ordained over it. The pillars of the earth. The earth shall not be moved. These are all concepts that a literal wooden interpretation fails to fully comprehend. And in context, you clearly see they're not speaking of anything in physics or astronomy. It's talking about governance. And so I find myself having to go to great lengths unpacking something that the deceivers have subtly twisted into confusion in a matter of seconds. It's a labor. So much harder. Somebody said that some of the effect that the truth, by the time it gets its shoes on, out of bed and gets its shoes on, the lie has traveled around the globe 7 times. It's very true. It's like a little child. You don't have to teach the child to do wrong. You don't have to teach the child to want to infect others with bad behavior. It's always, always harder to do the right thing. It's harder to live for Christ in a world under the control and sway of the devil and his deceptions. But this is the battle we're called to. Proclamation, the gospel of Jesus Christ above all.
So this is why this word it's an important word to know, and we have to reintroduce it into our discussions here. Otherwise, we're not going to be able to make any sense of what's going on right now in our moment in history.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like the coming age, the social order that was coming into being when Jesus was here. that would be Logos as well, would it?
It was it was St. John appropriating Greek philosophy. Okay, he wrote that gospel in Ephesus 500 years before he was there. Heraclitus was in Ephesus, and he was the first one to use Logos in some type of specific philosophical way.
Oh, my friends, I trust you see the subtlety of the deception here. The Apostle John, writing under the divine inspiration of the eternal living God, was not appropriating Greek philosophy when he spoke of the Logos. Yes, the term certainly did predate the writing of the Gospel of John. John did live in Ephesus, would have heard the term. But what John was doing was similar to what Paul did in Athens when he encountered the philosophers of Greece, the Stoics and the Epicureans, and showed them that while they were denoting an evidence of a similar thing, there was a greater truth to be understood from what they were recognizing. While the Greek philosophers could see a logos, which was reason, communication, the fabric of the universe, all things knit together, the cosmic cowlick, so to speak, and they even acknowledged a form of deity, they were denying the power thereof. They were not showing Christ in his fullness, the living God, the real Logos, the one with the power to save, the one with the power to give life, the one in whom all things consist and have their being. See for yourself the similarities to what Paul did in Athens here, as I read to you from Acts 17. Now while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. Therefore disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews, and with the devout persons, and in the market daily with them that met with him. Then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and of the Stoics encountered him, and some said, "What will this babbler say?" Others some, "He seemeth to be a setter forth of strange gods, because he preached unto them Jesus and the resurrection." And they took him and brought him unto Areopagus, which is where they debated, saying, "May we know what this new doctrine whereof thou speakest is? For thou bringest certain strange things to our ears. We would know, therefore, what these things mean." And the Bible includes a side note in Acts 17:21. "For all the Athenians and strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear some new thing." Similar to how man is today, is he not? Ever learning and never coming to the knowledge of the truth. Simple truth found in, by, and through Christ. "Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, 'Ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are too superstitious. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, To the unknown God, whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, him declare I unto you.'" So Paul's saying, "Hey, I was wandering around your city, and I saw the temple of this god, the altar to that god." I think there was something like over 300 gods they were worshiping in Athens in those days. "And you even have an altar here to an unknown god. Like you're trying to cover all your bases just in case there's something you left out." Well, there is someone you left out. The living God. The real God. Not all these idols. The one true God. And Paul says, "God that made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands." That's why you know he's the real God. He's not going to sit as a stone or a piece of wood or an idea in your temples, in your schools. He's not going to be limited to you. "Neither is worshipped with men's hands as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life and breath and all things, and hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on all the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation." Kind of just destroys all the racist ideologies being put forward by this group and that group in this neo-dark age, does it not? "That they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring." So he's saying even your pagan poets understand that we have a common source of life. but I'm proclaiming to you who that person is. This is the jump that you can't make through sheer logic and philosophy. You just gotta know. You gotta know him. You can't just argue your way. The closest you can get to God, and you can get there through logic, is the cause. He's the cause. He's not a bunch of gaps. He is the gap. He holds all things. You can logically understand that. You can't get something from nothing. But you can't know God unless you know Christ. This is who Paul is bringing to you. So he says, you can get to God. Your poets can even get you to God. But I'm proclaiming to you the Logos. For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone graven by art and man's device. And the times of this ignorant God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent. There's no excuse now. You got enough knowledge. You know better. Because he hath appointed the day in the which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained. Who's that man? The Logos, Jesus Christ. Whereof he hath given assurance unto all men, in that he hath raised him from the dead. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, and others said, we will hear thee again of this matter. So Paul departed from among them. That's what man does in his spiritually blind state. He mocks what he don't understand. He don't even realize what a miracle the natural world is. If you were raised in a world of concrete and fluorescent lighting, and you were told by some wild-eyed alien who came and invaded your world that there was another world where you could take these little specks that we call seeds, put them in the ground, and with sunlight, water, and atmosphere, you could get a plant to grow up out of the ground. Something as mighty and majestic as an oak tree, as beautiful as a rose bush, as life-sustaining as a stalk of corn or wheat. You'd think that man was insane. You don't even realize. But you take it for granted that because it is, therefore it is, and this is the natural world, and blah, 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 blah. No, nothing to see here, nothing to question, no big questions to ponder anymore. You don't even see the absolute miraculous nature of the natural world. So if you don't see what has been revealed, how are you going to see what hasn't? And you're going to make such asinine statements as John, writing of the Logos, the living God, the Spirit of the living God, the Word of the living God, was appropriating Greek philosophy because he was actually showing them what the mirror or the faint image that they had stumbled onto really was. This idea that it's just appropriating Greek philosophy is the way of diminishing and dismissing and marginalizing Christianity that the God-haters do when they say Christianity was just another religion. They point to what they perceive to be similarities between Christianity and religions that were existing at the time that Christ was on the earth, and they say, well, you're just borrowing from these other religions. Or they go back in history and say, Moses in the Old Testament, the Pentateuch, is the same as the Book of the Dead. Even though when you read the Book of the Dead of the Egyptians and the Sumerian writs and all these other different ancient fragments we have, there's nothing in them remotely similar to what Moses in the Old Testament was writing about. But what the real point is yes, there's always been counterfeits to the real thing. This is how the devil's deception works. He has been counterfeiting the real thing from the dawn of man. His subtle lie is, oh, God said that? Did he really say that? Yeah, what he was really trying to tell you was this. And then you turn it into some lie, some subtle twisting where you reduce all the power from it. You deny the power of God, even though you retain some semblance of godliness. You might even call it Christianity. So what does the Bible say? The Bible clearly says, from such, turn away. We know that this deceptions and rampant lies are the way of a fallen world. But praise be to God that he has given us his truth and power to be his sons spiritually and to discern his spiritual truths by virtue of being light and truth incarnate. Amen.
And the great religious leaders here tonight give us all an example that we can follow. We're living in a time and age that we never thought possible before. And we've got to come together, not only as a nation, but as a world community.
If there is no more protest, how can there be a Protestant church? Maybe we now we're all Catholics again.
We can also agree on the need to stand up to anti-Catholic bias.
Till we all come in the unity of the faith.
Of an abomination of God.
Amen.
How can there be a Protestant church?
You're going to be guilty of murder.
Of the Holy Father, Pope Francis.
Protest is over. If there is no more protest, how can there be a Protestant church?